artists and scientists are very similar. Both occupations attract people with total, almost obsessive personalities. People who are immersed in their journey to find another truth or tell another story. This is why both scientists and artists enjoy the reputation of, how shall I put it, maybe not being the easiest of people. So imagine a married couple, a scientist and an artist, who are not only married, but in fact even create together. Professor Assaf Vardi from the Department of Plant and Environmental Sciences studies the fragile ecosystem of the oceans and the effect global warming has on this environment. His partner, Nivi Alroy, is a world-renowned artist. Together, they will tell you the intricate story of the ocean through scientific and artistic presentation.
Let's start by taking a deep breath. We're about to dive into the deep ocean and explore how microbes have a dramatic impact on our planet. As a marine microbiologist, my passion is to deepen our understanding of how the ecology and evolution of this microorganism may shape life in the ocean. We specifically zoom into the bloom, into microbial life, in order to explore basic principle of how marine microbes sense, communicate, and adapt to changes in the environment. These beautiful microscopic creatures, as you can see here, are floating single-cell plankton that come in many shapes and forms. They have a fundamental role in our ocean big cycle of carbon, phosphate, nitrogen, and sulfur due to their unique metabolic imprint. These microbes have diverse metabolic capability that were shaped over millions of years in extreme habitats. In our lab, we focus on a specific phenomena with immense ecological importance, algal blooms in the ocean. During this fascinating event, photosynthetic single-cell organism called algae or phytoplankton can increase their density concentration reaching thousands of cells in just a drop of water. They can form massive blooms in the ocean that can stretch over thousands of kilometers in the ocean. During photosynthesis, cells can use the sun's energy to produce sugar by fixing about 50 billion tons of carbon annually while releasing oxygen. Half of our planet photosynthesis is derived from the activity of this microscopic algae in the ocean, this metabolic capability that they invented more than 2.8 billion years ago, an invention that changed our planet in an unrecognizable way. Interestingly, among all existing species, only just few selected species can proliferate, multiply themselves to these massive blooms in the ocean. A specific example is our lab organism of choice, our lead actor tonight, the algal species Emiliana huxley, that belong to the group of the coccolithophores. But we simply call it coco. Probably one of the most important cosmopolitan single-cell microbe in the ocean. This bug is decorated by beautiful, intricate calcium carbonate shell made of chalk. Since these blooms are the foundation of the entire marine food web and a major source for carbon and other nutrients, we are very much interested to understand the environmental factor that control not only the life of this bloom, but also the death of this of cocoa bloom. Here is where the plot thickens. We and others recently found that giant viruses are responsible for the demise of these blooms in the ocean. And although this bloom stretches over thousands of square kilometers in the ocean, these viruses can diminish the bloom with just a few couple of days. In recent years, we have been investigating how this host-virus interaction regulates the fate of cocoa blooms in the ocean. Specifically, we investigate the molecular basis of this interaction and we ask, what are the strategies employed by this virus to hijack the host metabolism in order to successfully reproduce and release new infectious viruses by killing the host in a very specific manner? But why the death of cocoa is so important for the ecology of the ocean? During the decline of cocoa bloom, thousands of tons of carbon, organic carbon, are released, fueling the entire marine food web, from bacteria to grazers to fish to whales. So when these infected algae cells die and disintegrate, they tend to aggregate and sink to the bottom of the ocean. Since these blooms are a major sink for atmospheric CO2 or carbon dioxide, there are key processes here of biological pump of this atmospheric CO2. But only a tiny fraction of this carbon that is fixed by the algae will eventually reach the ocean bed and will be buried there for thousands of years. This buried fossil matter is turned into oil over periods of millions of years. This is the fossil fuel we all use to burn for energy. This isn't the whole story. On another level, the demise of these blooms in the ocean will have a mirror effect. Instead of just downwards, upwards, with the release of volatiles into the atmosphere. One such smelly gas is the sulfuric molecule DMS. Millions of tons of this molecule are released to the atmosphere by stress algae, and it's actually responsible for the smell of the sea that we all know so well. DMS can be sensed as a food cue by seabird, fish, whales, penguin, and more. When released into the atmosphere, it can be oxidized to become aerosol and can act as cloud condensation nuclei, affecting rainfall, solar radiation that reaches the Earth. Together with Professor Danta Ofik here at Weizmann and our joint student Uriel Colombri, we made important discovery this year. We found the enzyme that is responsible for the production of DMS in the ocean. Probably one of the most important enzymes in the marine environment. But still many questions remain to be answered, And the big one regards the physiological and cellular role of this enzyme during cocoa bloom, and especially how they use it to fight viral infection in grazer, and what is role in chemical communication between different members of the community. This grand impact of DMS molecule exemplify of how single cell floating in the ocean experience stress or pathogen attack can have a major consequence on ocean atmosphere feedback. All of these magnificent creatures that we saw tonight are not just the fruit of my or Nivi's imagination. This is how this footage looked like from the real microscope in the lab. This is important other group of algae in the ocean, the diatom. They are really famous for their intricate shell made of silica, which is a great inspiration for the nanotechnological world that tried to mimic this incredible nanostructure in the nanoscale. Importantly, another major focus in my lab is to understand communication in the ocean, since this single cell can actually form communities during the bloom. So we ask how information is being transferred from a single cell up to community and to the bloom, and what is the chemical language used between individuals during biotic interaction. And although we're dealing here with single cell, we can actually watch this single cell from space using satellite data. Like plants, they contain pigments, chlorophyll molecules that change the color of the ocean, as we see here in this satellite image. So we can actually use it to quantify the impact of this phenomena on large scale. This is another great example of relict, fantastic relict of this bloom, the famous cliff of Dover in the UK, that is actually made from the skeleton, the chalky skeleton of billions of cocoa cells that led into the sediment over geological time. As I mentioned, our passion in my lab is to understand algal bloom at all scale, from the molecular single cell level to thousands of square kilometers during the bloom, from lab-based investigation of their genomes and metabolic capabilities up to chasing this bloom literally in the marine environment by scientific expedition. And this is exactly what we did a few years ago using this boat here, crossing the Atlantic Ocean from the Azores Island up to Reykjavik, Iceland, to chase after this bloom. Luckily, we were able to catch not only cocoa bloom, but also to catch the viral epidemics event in action, and to quantify it for the first time, the impact of this host-virus interaction on the macroscale environment. This year, we joined a very interesting international three-year project, the Tara Ocean Expedition, on this boat here, one of the most important projects in marine sciences, aiming to characterize the ocean microbiome in response to climate changes. Together with Professor Ilan Koren here at the Weizmann, expert in cloud physics, we for the first time try not only to sample the ocean, but to try to correlate, to link between the ocean ecology to the atmosphere and its impact on the atmosphere. Exactly as I've shown you tonight, through zooming in into the phenomena and also zooming out, in order to get important insight of how microbes change our planet. And cocoa was just one example of such. Lastly, please don't forget to thank algae for every second breath you take, and consider responsibility for the environment around us.